We are incredibly happy and deeply honoured this week to have the wonderful Cassandra Khaw on. They are one of our favourite humans, one of our favourite writers.
And we miss them very much.
And we miss them very much.
Yes. Okay, quick, we got to get them on camera real fast. So let's continue embarrassing them on screen, okay? How about that?
Just so you know, there's a non-zero chance we won't talk about the book. We'll just tell you how lovely you are and how amazing you are and how much we miss you for like an hour. So, you know,
yeah, that's,
buckle up.
That sounds like yeah. us, right? Doesn't it?
Hi, Cass. How
Hi.
You doing?
We haven't even finished introducing you yet. We're already fawning all over ourselves to compliment you because you're wonderful and we do miss you desperately. It's been years since we've seen you. But we went to that amazing Chinese restaurant with the bar and the crab and the pork belly buns.
Flesh and buns.
Flesh and buns, Flesh wasn't and it?
Buns. Yeah. Flesh and buns.
Oh, I still think about that place.
Just
I do
as well. One of the absolute best meals. Seriously, that's in like the top 10 best meals I've ever had.
Yeah, and it's in, it was in, was it Neil's Yard, Soho?
Yes.
I can't remember exactly where it was.
Because
Seven Vales.
Yeah.
That's it.
It was good. It was a kind of a divey place, but it was all, you know, it's that thing that London does. It looks divey on the outside and it's super posh on the inside, and it was fantastic.
The bathroom was a little bit questionable, though, with all the pornographic stuff all over the
wall. Oh, I'm glad I missed that. That would have been awkward. The other thing we should warn you about, Cassandra's audio is just fine, but they're in their kitchen, so there's probably a little tiny bit of echoing going on. I'll turn them up just a touch. The other thing to warn everybody about is Cassandra has kitties.
Yes.
And they have been wandering across their lap during this the tech test, and I'm sure if we ask nicely, Cassandra will pick up the bag of treats and shake it, and at some point a cat will arrive and become the center of attention, as is their due. So just to warn everybody, all the Catboy fans are gonna have a good night, let's just say.
We have some welcome familiar faces in the chat. I'm seeing Brendan. I'm seeing Scott.
Uh-huh. Fantastic. That sounds
Brendan
great.
Brendan is dropping puzzles in there, as is his wont, because he is our puzzle master. Good job, sir.
So quick, we kind of interrupted the introduction because we wanted to talk to you so quickly.
Yes.
So we're going to talk about, you have two books out this year. One science fiction.
Three.
Oh, crap. I missed one.
So
one science fiction, like kind of reversed-y, heisty thing. One horror novella, which I consumed in 6 hours and got a sunburn because I was reading it at the pool and I couldn't put the book down. So thank you for that. It was great. So I have a mazillion freckles
You're
now.
Welcome.
Yeah, it was great. We'll talk about that one too. What's the third one?
It's a novella in an anthology, Italian anthology for World of Darkness called Walk Among Us.
Mm-hmm.
I have a novella entitled Find Friends in It.
Oh, that sounds amazing.
That sounds really cool. Very good. Okay, so there's lots of Cassandra material out there. So before we get like terribly excited and just run away with the interview, do you want to do a little bit of an opening monologue? Because we gave you two different options and you didn't tell us which one you picked. So I'm kind of waiting for the surprise on this. This will be great. So we had content warnings for the monologue. That covers both options because we weren't sure which one was going to be read. And remember, you can always follow the link in the chat for detailed content warnings. And we'll give content warnings for both of the books when we come on to discussing them. But now, Cassandra's going to read us something.
All right. I am going to read Proxima, and I'm terribly bad at dramatic reading, so
That's
I'm
fine.
Just going to read it like I'm a new stuff.
Don't worry about it.
That's fine.
Sarah Evergreen has trained her whole life to be an astronaut. When her number finally comes up, it's just a late replacement on the Proxima crew. She'll be in space for a year as part of a mission, which forms a major stepping stone towards landing on Mars. It's all she ever wanted. But her daughter, Stella, oh my God, I'm not butchering the actor's name, and her ex, Thomas, similarly not butchering the actor's name, are less thrilled. Likewise, Mike, Matt Dillon, the mission commander. With the pressure tightening and the launch window approaching, Sarah must prove to everyone around her she's making the right choice, including herself.
Mm.
Written and directed by Alice Winnicott. before with, oh God.
What's the last name?
Jean-Stéphane Blanc. Proxima makes a surprising great double bill with Sorry to Bother You. Both center people dedicated to doing the right thing, taking a moment to check whether they're doing the right thing for them too, and acting accordingly. But where the third act of Sorry to Bother You jumps the rails in the best way, Proxima slides smoothly down the ramp and off into space. Or to put it another way, Sorry's cash finds his own destiny in the wreckage. Sarah really has hurt, clings all the tighter to it. This is an odd and welcome role for Green, and she brings all of her best qualities to bear. Her wry humor, almost unidentifiable accent, and arch wit are in abundance.
Yay.
But tempered by just how much pressure Sarah is under. She's furiously determined to prove everybody wrong, desperate both to be a good mother and for life to be something in addition to motherhood. All contradictory, all acting on her all the time, and all of them weaving around one another like a vice over a funnel, all leading up to the launch. Sarah will get there. Whether she'll be allowed to feel good about it is a different matter.
Mm.
The script's singular weakness speaks directly to this. Mike, an excellent, understated performance by Dylan, makes a sexist comment about Sarah at her introductory press conference that would get him benched. It's that simple.
Mm.
It's worth noting, too, that it's not that he said it that makes it weak writing. It's that it's, he says it in front of the press, the very people he will have had literal years of training in how to handle. This is the one place Mike and the movie trade veracity for drama, and it takes a lot of the second act to work off the lingering sour taste. Proxima shows us the astronaut program as perceived, not its reality. The sexism is still there, as it is in all workplaces, but subtle, insidious in the same way.
Mm.
Sarah roots it out just the same. Not that should be her job, but it's not like anyone else is going to do it. Because in the end, that's the real common ground of Proxima and Sorry to Bother You. Both feature protagonists forced to take on the emotional labor of something they aren't for the greater good.
Yeah.
Both feature those protagonists pushing back and risking everything for a small gain. Best of all, both featured these protagonists triumphing in entirely different ways. For Cash, it's catharsis. For Sarah, the tranquility of high orbit and the job well done. Both with the knowledge that a change that had to come is here and their lives may at last be their own, or at least different. A small victory, all the same. Proxima is supple, quiet, involving, and very good. If you like the first, you'll love this. Widely available from 23rd November.
Brilliant.
Nice.
Thank you very much.
Well done.
Shall we dive on in?
Yeah. Okay. So, when did we meet? I'm trying to remember. Like, I know that we were friends on Twitter for a while before we met, because didn't I like totally squee at you at Nine Worlds 1 year? And that's when we first met.
I think so, yes. I think it was around the time that Rupert Wong had just been published in the year or two after that. And
yeah.
I was sort of confusedly pinballing through the publishing industry still.
Yeah, exactly.
I think this was around the same time I met you at a fantasy con. And we were trying to track down...
Always a mixed message.
Yeah. We were trying to track down a book launch for a book that you were in, which was having a launch at that fantasy con, but actually had no copies. And I don't think it was actually...
Yeah.
Yeah.
British publishing, sometimes in a nutshell. Exactly.
Here is a book. Kind of.
I'm trying... When I was getting ready for this interview, I was trying to think about... Because you've written for, like, almost every format now. You know, you've done prose, you've done nonfiction, you work for Ubi, you're a writer for Ubi, you've done comics, you've done visual novels. I don't know if you've done audio drama yet, and if not...
I've not done audio dramas, and I've not done anything to do with, like, TV or film. I'm very interested in getting to audio dramas, but... If I take on anything extra right now, I think Michael is going to fly over to Montreal to strangle me.
That's okay. I mean, it's August. It's late July. It's August. We're planning for 2022, right?
She says the same thing.
I'm writing this down, Cassandra. I'm writing this down. 2022 audio drama, Cassandra. Okay, good, good. We're making plans.
I'm picturing Michael sitting in the audience of Cook. Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, no. Where is she going?
Exactly. But was that your intention with your writing career? Because you've come in at... When I think about your career, and I think of it as like a portfolio career, and that you've done a mazillion trillion things and kind of assembled something altogether, Cassandra's the other person who has had a writing career similar to yours, and that the both of you just desperately, I don't know if it's desperately, I only see his end, I should not project, but the both of you just kind of grab at everything that comes across, and then you're frustratingly talented at all of it, and then you wind up in this horrible situation where you're like, okay, I gotta pick a lane at least long enough to finish a thing. Was that your intent when you started with writing? Was it just, oh, I'm just gonna give this a try, and then you got swept away by the ridiculous tide of your talent?
See,
remember what I mean? I said I didn't have any compliments for you to read out loud like we did with some other other guests, so I'm just going to bombard you with compliments.
They're just going to be lightly scattered through the remainder of the interview. It'll be fine.
Exactly. And remember, if you ever get terribly embarrassed, just shake the bag of cat treats and the cat will show up and you'll have a reprieve. It's perfect, right? We've got this totally planned.
Oh, yes, the question. Actual answer. I kind of bumbled into the whole writing thing. I'm originally grateful to David Moore for taking a chance on Rupert Wong. Mm-hmm. And kind of once I got in, well, like my foot in the door, I was really curious about what else I could do. And it was just like, oh gosh, I wonder if I will be terrible at this. I don't know if I, until I try it. And I go headbutt the wall until I get results.
That
slowly
sounds...
pulling the bag. Cat treats closer.
Because I think it's safe to say that the variety of genre, at least, that you're best known for is broadly cosmic horror, and that you like,
yes,
you like mythological components, you like squickiness, you're not shy of body horror.
And food.
And you like food, which I think is fantastic.
You are one of the only authors I've ever encountered who can horrify me and make me go, I would like to eat that, in the same paragraph, more than once.
That makes me very happy to know. It's something I enjoy being able to do. My favorite comments are when people show up and go like, you made me hungry, and I'm very disturbed by this. And I always carry this problem in my heart.
Wonderful.
I'm hungry and conflicted by this fact. Could be a Jordan t-shirt. I am hungry and scared at the same time, right? Exactly.
Yeah. But yeah, cosmic horror. I think you didn't really ask this, so I'm just kind of jumping in on the tangent here. I think I really got drawn to it while I was doing that nomadic thing. Mm. For the last decade or so. And it really kind of hit me how anonymous our world is in a weird way. And we hear a weird noise behind the wall in our neighbors, and we don't think too much of it. We just assume something's going. Sometimes we hear shouting as well. And then our normal instincts to go, I'm sure this will resolve itself. Oh, this is not my business. And it's always kind of just stuck in my head, like, what if there's a tentacular horror there? What if, like, a horrible sacrifice is taking place? 99% of people will never do anything because we're kind of socialized to go, this is not, like, this is not our lane, this is not our home, this is not our business. And that kind of extends further into studies themselves. Like, the thing that I realized while traveling, and it's a weird thing because I love this as well, it's so easy to just vanish into the world. It's so easy to just get swallowed up by a different country, by a journey, to just not show up at the end of the other destination.
Mm-hmm. And now the chat is starting to understand why it is we wanted to interview you the week after. So last week we talked to Maddie O.K. Smith, who's the creator of an excellent audio drama called Neighborly, which is one of the premises premises of
which
you're
is
the
a
English
fantastic
major.
Pun you just accidentally go. Made
what,
by the way
it, really
premises
it oh says, oh okay very nicely
because each episode of Neighborly takes place in a different house
in the house and it, one of the oh. the premises is how well do you know your neighbors. And they kind of play with that very concept you were talking about, okay, well, that was a noise. Is that just somebody knocking something off a shelf or is that a tentacular horror? And you show us, the Rupert Wong books especially, show us one Croydon. I'll never forget that because I was commuting into London at the time. And so reading about Rupert disappearing into Croydon was like, oh.
Oh,
yeah.
Buddy.
Oh, buddy.
Oh, I feel you.
I feel you. I feel you. But Rupert has, he's, the kind of the premise of that book, or at least the way I think about it, is what if you're the normal guy in the supernatural story? You know, you're the poor schmo who has to clean up after these fools or interact with the police or answer the normal questions. Or in Rupert's case, you're just the chef, man. somebody in our chat was talking about how they read Food of the Gods right after Matt Wallace's Sin du Jour books, which is another
fantastic
pairing.
I
right?
love that series so much.
Oh my gosh, the two of you should do something together that's entirely food related. And then for like the promo tour, we could do like a Binging with Babish versus Joshua Wiseman like cooking show
Author
thing.
Food truck, that's all I'm saying.
Author food truck.
Oh.
Oh, because now I'm going to leverage and I need to stay focused. Okay, okay. That's such
so,
a great
yeah.
screenshot, yes.
Cosmic
the pie in the sky director.
I love it, right? You know, serve a fantastic course of meals with little short story pairings, and I love it. I love it.
So I think that's one of the things which I really responded to with the Rupert books. That simultaneous combination of a vast, unknowable eldritch cosmic horror and, you know, the fact that some particular aspect of it is going, I want chips. Make me chips. And it just... it anchors the horror in a really fascinating way that doesn't belittle it or give you the reassurance of laughing at it. It's just, it's like a sudden, it's like the thing which I think all your books do to varying degrees, and it really popped for me with the Rupert ones. Suddenly you see exactly where you are on the food chain.
Viscerally.
And you... and you, it's like on the other side of the table there is the tentacular apex predator who can and will eat you, but just goes, all right, for now.
Well, yeah, it's more like a, hello, I am an ancient, you know, prehistoric deity slash creature that was worshipped as a deity, and your continued existence in the face of my stare is based on your chips. It's like, oh boy, talk about, yeah, just the perspective on there. What is it about?
There's a reason why Rupert's a good cook.
Right. Exactly. Exactly. What is it about cosmic horror that you like? Is it a tool set that you like exploring? Is it something about the way that it kind of sets up an expectation with your audience about certain subject matter? What first drew you to writing in that kind of wheelhouse?
A little bit of all those things, really. It's a lot of what I touched on earlier, like the anonymity of our world and how easy it is to vanish mm-hmm. into it. But it's also kind of just seeing how people treat others, how small we can be
mm-hmm.
compared to the powers, the authorities, the billionaires, how they look at us as something inconsequential.
Mm.
It's also just tapping into that sense of, and I think it always just kind of ties back to my travels. Being nomadic for 10 years definitely made me realize I am a tiny speck of dust on a long, long road of like the universe's history.
Like, to the point where it made me nervous, where I was like, Cassandra, please text me when you get there. type, you know, my full stream mom vibes kick in a couple of times. It's like, are you okay? I need to check in on you. Are you all right?
I remember that. Thank you so much. But also sad. I think it's just externalizing that feeling and that realization of being intensely, incredibly small, but also at the same time realizing that us as, you know, human beings and people, we still can affect the world. We can still affect each other, our society.
Mm-hmm.
And it doesn't really matter that our achievements, our communities will not outlive the next century or so. The thing that matters is we're trying for each other right now. And the duality of that has always fascinated me. Mm. And also cosmic horror means I can just run around in a circle inventing horrible, horrible things and no one expects very specific imagery out of it. And my favorite thing to do is to create terrible, terrible, scary nightmare creatures.
So that's an interesting segue, because one of the things that I really like that you did with Nothing But Blackened Teeth is you kind of flipped that premise, and that the way I'm going to describe the book without giving any spoilers is take this Scooby-Doo gang, give them fuck you money, and put them in a Japanese horror house. And let nature take its course.
Okay, right now, at least some of you in the chat are going, that sounds really cool. It is better than you know.
It's really, really, really good. But you take that concept of being small and insignificant and still having the ability to do change, and you flip it around to, these are people who have the power and the influence and the ability to really go and do something if they want to. And it's that dinosaur comic from Atomic Robo. But I don't want to cure cancer. I want to invent dinosaurs. So these rich assholes decide that instead of curing the plague or something, they're going to go fuck around with ghosts. And I'm like, and you deserve what you got as a result. Neater, neater.
Just for the record, watching Marguerite read this next to the pool last week in Bournemouth was so good.
Yes, I was sitting there going, you idiot! Oh my god! No, you fool! No! Yeah, I was yelling. I was yelling at the book. There were other people at the pool and they were not pleased with me. And I don't care, because the book was
fine.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a good, another way of putting it. Somebody in the chat has said, well, actually, I do want rich people to get haunted. I'm like, yes, that could be a good tagline for this book.
Do the blackened teeth eat the rich? Read the book.
Yes, read the book. Read the book. Trust me. You'll have happy feelings at the end. Yes.
Exactly. And it's crammed full of just those incredible turns of phrase, which are vintage you. The description of corpses of books at one point was just...
And again, it's that, I think a lot of it for me, it comes from that kind of afraid of that framing of sensuousness. You write in a way that really fully leverages all the senses. And so your descriptions for things are very visceral, and they're rooted a lot of the time in the body or in a sense. So you're describing things like corpses or skins or hair, or, you know, you're making analogies to parts of bodies or the sensations of bodies as a way of, and I think what it does is it makes us viscerally experience what's happening in a way that you can't get away with. I mean, we know one of the powers of audio fiction is the fact that you don't plug your ears when you listen to something. You know, yeah. You can skim read with a book, but when you listen to something, it's a different sensual experience. It's a different in-depth and intimate experience. And I think your writing, more so than almost anybody else's I can name, does that with your prose. You ground those analogies and those descriptions in familiar sensations that refuse to let the audience get away from empathizing and experiencing those horrible, horrible things.
And it's not just sensations, it's experiences too. My favorite thing I think about Nothing But Blackened Teeth is the fact that the protagonists are all friends. They are a group of people who have interacted with one another and dated and cheated on one another and have had the corners knocked off.
Mm.
And anyone who's known people for an extended period of time has, in many, almost in a lot of cases, those people who will call you at 3 a.m. and go, I've got a problem. And you're like, I'm out the door. What do you need?
Mm.
And this is almost a curdled version of that. This is a group of people who are throwing themselves headlong into these increasingly extreme situations because they don't want to look at who they are when they're not in them. And that really ties it into the thing.
Okay, I have to I'm sorry to cut off.
It's fine.
I have to revise my description. It's the Scooby-Doo gang in a Japanese horror house in a pressure cooker.
There we go.
Because
that's it.
Just all they do is just sit and stew and bounce off each other and ratchet each other up. Sorry.
And it, you can draw a straight line between nothing but black and teeth backwards through kind of classic horror like threads and like the first version of Haunting on Hill House. And
for me, the experience was specifically a lot of kind of what I will call the modern resurgence of Japanese horror. So we start with The Ring. The Fatal Frame video game was never out of my head when I was reading this book because, again, it has that those kind of visceral experiences and just the kind of almost the rhythm of the emotional confrontation is very different in those kind of books as well. And it always reminded me of that because, you know, there's a really well-established rhythm, I guess you'd say it, with what I'll call Western teenage horror, like the Scream movies, right? It's ooga booga, run, 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 ooga booga, run, 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 ooga booga, somebody's dead.
Latin?
Right?
No.
Yeah, and
Latin, yes, is also a common
actor. Western presentations of horror are very, very different. They tend, I mean, there's lots of different ways to do it, but this particular oeuvre reminds me, and I think it's the brilliance of why you set it in the Japanese house, is it dictated the style and the pacing that of the horror reveals, in that it's small and insidious, and then it's right here! And then someone's dead. And then someone's dead. Which is, yeah.
Also, as a brief aside, talking to Wendy, who may be the only other person in the chat who remembers it, I'm really sorry I brought up threads.
I love your analysis of that. Like, I think that book was definitely very deeply influenced by me growing up in so much Asian horror. I don't think I really consumed any Western horror until I was in my early 20s, honestly. Everything else was like the old Hong Kong movies, stuff from Southeast Asia. I have very much influenced, I think, by the original version of The Eye. I absolutely hated the Western remake more than anything else in my life. I'm sorry for any fans out there.
Yeah.
And also the Thai horror film Shutter. Like, those are really, really big things in my life, and I think it kind of speaks true into nothing but black and teeth.
I think the pacing, very much so. Like I said, the kind of the structure of the plot and the development and the timing of the reveals felt very grounded in the sense of space, which was fantastic. And you combine that, of course, with your ridiculously lush, bodily rooted descriptions, and I'm like, I'm reading on a Kindle, right? But it's like, I can't throw the book because the pool's right there, but I want to throw the book because I'm reading it.
I love that.
No throwing the Kindle.
Don't throw the Kindle. Don't throw the Kindle.
I love that you describe your writing style as baroque. And that's exactly it.
Because it does. It has all those lovely little curly cues and that wonderful, wonderful depth. But at the same time, it's not, and now I shall give you 3 pages worth of adequately describing the feast sequence. You know, it's not, I'm going to say it. It's not performative. It is rooted in your authentic voice, and I realize authenticity is probably a bad choice of term there, but you know, you and I have sat down across the dinner table together and shared meals, and so I know how native to your experience talking about food and you know, describing things through food is. And yeah, it's just really good. You write real good. Okay, no, I gotta find a better way to say this.
That's the name of the show. Shoot it, print it, stuff it. That's the name of the show.
No. You pack more in a sentence than some people pack in chapters. And then you just layer them sentence after sentence after sentence. And so you get this incredibly dense, lush, visceral experience. And it almost distracts you from, like, the events that are going on, because you're just, you know, you're just consuming this lovely, dense, luscious prose, and then all of a sudden, there's a lady and she wants to kill you and you have to pay attention again. That's kind of how I describe that book.
There is a description which I first heard Neil Gaiman use, which is a writer's job is to take you by the hand, lead you down an alley and go, trust me, and then let go. And I much prefer how I view yours, which is that your writing takes you by the hand, leads you down the alley, and slowly tightens its grip. And the whole time, it's maintaining eye contact.
Right, but everything, but then the eyes start slowly glowing as you get further down into the alley, and it's too far to find your way out anymore. And then it's not so much a grip as, like, it's starting to dig in, and you can feel blood being drawn, but you can't see it, and there's just these lightly glowing eyes, and then it's the end, and you're like, ah, good night. You know?
And yeah. I think as we've been talking about this, that's actually shaken loose one of the other things I think about an awful lot. I am a
embossed and
embossed and filigreed
is an excellent description. Yes, very much so.
I am a frustrated stand-up comedian, which surprises no one who's met me for less than about 25 seconds. And as a result, I respond really well to language which is simultaneously economic and driving. And there's always this second thing going on with what you write, which is the story is going along. And in some cases, like with Nothing But Blackened Teeth, it's going along deceptively leisurely. But the whole time, you're right there, and you're always giving the reader information and always pushing things further along and always leading them further down. And my formal training, and I'm not sure whether I've ever told you this, is as a close-up stage magician. And that's one of I was
Entertainer of the Year Isle of Man.
Manx Young Entertainer of the Year, 1988. I promise you, my mom still has the shield.
I'm having that. Excuse me, I just need to make a note and text his mother.
And one of the things that taught me, I didn't realize it was teaching me at the time. I kind of had to go away to university and combine it with that. Was I really appreciate the journey with a story, with a piece of fiction, with a piece of art. I really appreciate when a creator takes time and care to show you each part of what they're doing and why it's significant and why it's important, and then subverts it. And you do both of those, mm-hmm. because the fact that people of your talent do cosmic horror is the thing that means cosmic horror is still interesting.
Yeah, people like your writing, Premi Muhammad's writing, you know, people bringing new perspective and new stories and new experiences and new life experiences to cosmic horror, because we all know the foundations, shall we say, of cosmic horror, and it's rooted in old racist dead white guys, and it's the reason why that particular genre.
I just want the record to show she went to the dead white guy joke first. I actually had the "Hi, Uncle Howard, still dead? Good." moment primed and ready to go.
Keep spinning, fucker. We're like powering satellites off your rotating corpse. Anyway, sorry. Hey, I can swear.
I love you.
It's my stream. He can sue me. Bring it on, the ghost of H.P. Lovecraft. Be my guest.
Sue me. Sue me in England.
That's an inside joke that only you get.
That's why I'm laughing.
But that genre completely stagnated as a result, is that its experiences were not relevant and not relatable to so many people. And you being one of this new group of people bringing new life into an established genre and showing us all new horrible squicky things is really lovely.
So let's talk about science fiction.
So then, having conquered cosmic horror, how did you decide to write science fiction?
The All-Consuming World was actually originally a tie-in novella for a project. It didn't quite work out because the person who commissioned it went through some life stuff, and things got just kind of shallowed, and eventually I saw the bones of this book, and my agent talked to the person who commissioned us, and we got the rights back, and they filed off the serial numbers, and just sat there going, like, I have no idea what I'm going to do with this. And on a whim, I sent it out to a bunch of people, including Sarah Gwen in Erewhon, going, like, do you want to take a look? I think there's something interesting here. I just don't know what to do with it.
Mm-hmm.
And Sarah took it one step even further, and she kind of came back to me when I noticed that I was a novella, but I'm pitching this as a full book and taking this as, like, sample pages. Are you willing to write a full book? I'm like, oh, yeah. And
your agent made you do it. I love it.
No, my agent. My agent was like, going, Jack, what are you doing? I just ran over to Sarah, my editor at Erewhon. I just spent a lot of time so staring. He's like, Cass? He's very used to this at this point of our lives together. But yeah, with Sarah's guidance, and I owe her the world on this, honestly. I was so nervous about writing and pulling novel. Like, as you know, most of my stuff has been novella-like things, shorter stories, and so forth. And I remember just sending Sarah so many emails, but I had no idea how to write a novel. Oh, God, why did I agree to it? I will shave you. Let me step, commit seppuku. This is terrible. And Sarah's like, no, this is what we're going to try to do. And she kept going through things with me, being very reassuring.
Mm.
And eventually, the all-consuming world kind of came out of that. From rounds of revision and her fantastic critique, her editorial guidance. I know I was supposed to talk about the book itself. I ended up gushing about Sarah, but I will stand by it.
That's fine.
We are huge process nerds here. That is always something which we love to see.
Totally fine. So do you find like that it sounds like you find the novella length kind of your comfortable zone, and then you got pushed. You were like, okay, Ken,
yes.
You were challenged. Let's not say pushed. That implies it's a train or a bus. You were challenged to explore this out into a further form. How did you find that experience? I mean, it sounds like you had great support, but it was outside your comfort zone.
It was utterly terrified. I will not lie. I generally spent months running around in circles going, oh God, I have no idea what I'm doing, and had to be gently steered back towards it. But my co-writer for another novel, because clearly I like challenges and won't just smash my head against a wall until I beat them, Richard Caffrey, I'm co-writing a book with him called The Dead Takes the A-Train.
Mm-hmm.
He sort of helped reframe the whole process for me as well. I spent several nights wailing at him over Zoom, going, I don't know what I'm doing. A lot of the people in my life had to hear that conversation. And he was like, think of it as three different novellas, each of them dealing with specific acts and arc, and that also helped a lot.
So you're a
It broke it down in my head.
So you're a planner, then. You want to be able to plan things out.
No, that was the other bit, too. I'd never done any sort of plotting in anything else I'd ever written until I got to that book.
You just wake up in a fugue state 3 days later and there's a novella on your computer. Yeah.
Okay, so...
The horrifying vastness of the novel format.
So, kind of the first two things I want to pull out from that are, firstly... Well done. You are genuinely the only author I've ever met who has successfully rescued a torpedoed piece of licensed fiction.
Thank you.
It's hard to do.
Thank you.
Well, it's hard to do because a lot of the time when you're commissioned to write for somebody else's IP, that is such a fundamental component of the work that filing the serial numbers off isn't so much an adequate description as, well... I knocked it down to the foundation, and maybe the chimney is there, but you have to do a lot of rewriting it, don't you?
I did a ton of rewriting, and most of it, honestly, was driven by sheer spite, because I get very angry at things I do not know, and I want to go conquer it.
There's nothing wrong with spite for art, right? There's nothing wrong with spite for art.
But the second thing was really, despite all the other difficulties that you explained very well, I felt Maya had a story to tell. She's very much an abuse victim. She had spent literally hundreds of years being tortured by her abuser, with her like brain chemicals being carefully readjusted mm-hmm. by the woman. And she has died over and over and over again in the name of her abuser.
Yeah, let's and jump in for a second real quick with just a content warning. So it's okay. I'm just going to reiterate for the chat really quick. The all-consuming world is heavy and deep and deals a lot with what you can do with technology and abuse control. So please do heed the content warnings for it. But we're not going to spoil anything. But speaking of rage-driven,
thing, I always love it when ideas coincide in the right time, where people who've independently developed stuff come to fruition at similar times. And the fact that Leverage Redemption has hit, and the fact that the all-consuming world, and Once More Into the Void, which is a role-playing game about starship crews being brought together to do one last job after their captain royally screwed up. I adore that the premise of all-consuming world is, so, we did this heist. Yeah. And it went incredibly wrong. Yeah. Let's figure out how. And I just... The idea of deconstructing the heist narrative at the same time as exploring the concepts of abuse and the power structures within all that, and also the colossal artificial intelligences and the vast, almost science fictional analog of the cosmic horror ideas that you love, all landing in one place, that is a hell of a thing. I mean, that's a hell of a thing for...
Well, let's be honest. Her editor was right. There was really good stuff in there for you to work with. And I'm hoping when this interview is over, you're going to DM me what the IP was, because I'm terribly curious now. But don't say that on the stream. No. Let's not get in trouble.
It's fine. It's all fine. Let's move on.
But yeah, I just needed to tell Maya, sorry. She was very different, and she was just so angry subconsciously at everything that was happening to her and trying to survive it. And I think there was a part of me, and this sounds a little bit woo-woo, I just don't want to leave her there in the unfinished novella and leave her trapped with her abuser for all kinds of, I understand she's a fictional character in my head, but I needed to give her peace. She couldn't stay in that hell.
Oh no, I totally get that. Yeah. I've seen different variants of that. I've seen writers talk about different variants of that.
Just finished Jen Williams' book, Dog Roast Dirt, today. And yes. There's very much an... Jen Williams is a good fantasist friend of ours here in the UK. Her Crime debut just came out this week, I think.
I believe it did,
It's finally out. And Jen takes, I think, a very similar approach in that book, in that there are vast swaths of characters or people of certain identities and genders who just get done dirty by certain genres. And I'm really here for people who are reclaiming the agency and the voices of those characters. And I haven't had a chance to read The All-Consuming World yet, but I'm hella gonna go do it now. Because it sounds like reverse heist and kicking an abuser to the curb. Yep, sign me up. I'm there. I'm totally there.
I'm very curious to hear what you think when you're done. Hopefully,
I will. I will text you. Don't worry. It's all good.
So, horror, science fiction, tie-in fiction. Let's talk about toolkits. Is there anything... are there things that you find yourself... like ideas or concepts or techniques that you find yourself reaching for, depending on whether you're working on something which is tie-in or something which is your own? Does your style shift at all?
It does. With tie-in work, I spend a lot of time rereading the material that it is pulled from. I like lean very heavily on the lore managers, on whoever's in charge of maintaining lore, and they try to figure out the tenets of the IP in order to get things to work the way they should.
Mm-hmm.
So far, that's been pretty good. Like, I've had good success with that, except for one IP that I'm not going to name because I am polite. But
my DMs are open.
I will send you. But it essentially amounted to them going, hey, write this thing in your style. I'm like, cool. And then they came back to me and were like, we cannot have any violence whatsoever in this. And I remember just staring at my email going,
then why did you hire me?
Could you talk about food less?
Why did you hire me?
Yeah, that, exactly. That's like somebody going, could you talk about food less? I'm like, why did you hire Cassandra Khaw? And, unfortunately, I probably have answers to that question, and none of those are polite either. So let's just quickly move on, shall we?
I have to confess, when I was doing the tie-in RPG work with Doctor Who, I was always the asshole that tested the fences. Because I was young and stupid, and I thought I would be able to achieve useful things. And no, what I achieved was a polite note from my editor going, this is really good, stop it.
Yes. Your bones have been... Yeah, I see your skills. Knock it off, son, you bother me. It's kind of how I
thought. The windmill's ass has been well and truly kicked. Now write the fucking project, Alasdair. You know?
Sort of this is a complete segue, but I just want to jump in to say, because I want more people to pressure this person. So I've written some work for Sunless Skies and Fallen London.
Yes, excellent pair of games.
They have an internal style guide that Chris Gardner put together about how to write prose, how to convey lushness, how to keep it economical and clear and approachable while still being beautiful and baroque. And it is the most gorgeously written style guide and guide on writing I've ever seen in my life, bar none. He will not publish it or his books. And I'm so mad because the man is insanely talented in every way, including as an educator.
Damn.
You should play Fallen London and Sunless Skies if you have not. But seriously, that style guide, when I looked at it, I still reference it every now and then when I'll figure out my own work.
How do we convince this person to run courses or publish his work? Because that sounds amazing.
It does.
I don't know, but he really should. It is just so marvelously well done in such a compassionate way that is incredibly inclusive and incredibly conscious of the fact that everyone has different writing styles. And yeah, it's just so good. To burn out a little bit more, it's something I'm very bad at because I can't have a tendency to wander off on my own tangents. But one of the main things she talks about is you're allowed to have an incredibly lush sentence full of $10 words, et cetera, et cetera, as long as you have one clear key phrase to form the skeleton of it. Like, everything needs a frame, you know, muscle your skin, but you have the bones of it right there. If you do not have the bones, it becomes this formless, mushy nightmare of prettiness.
I think the chat was talking earlier about the concept of globsters. Globsters are
lobster.
A globster is an unidentified piece of sea animal that has washed ashore. They can't tell what it is, and so they just call it a globster. So now I'm thinking about this sentences as globsters if they don't have those underlying bones. You're just fond of bones. Let's be honest.
That you, or some of the people in the chat, have never seen this, and as a result, I envy you. When you get the opportunity, put the phrase dynamite whale through YouTube.
Really, honey? You're gonna do that to a friend?
Oh, no. Why did you do that to people?
Well, because they couldn't move it off the beach, and because they lived in a place where dynamite was readily available. So that's the solution that they came up with.
I am going through a phase at the moment where I have a tremendous appreciation for comic timing, accidental or intentional. And there is a moment after the thing you know will happen, the moment you hear the phrase, dynamite whale, happens, where there is silence, and then there is not silence. And that transition makes me laugh so hard, I can't breathe.
Oh my.
I have seen this video many times. Do take a look.
I've watched that video.
It's just when those chunks start falling. It's like, oh.
I always viewed its spiritual successor as my favorite piece of understated interview, which was when I believe a bull seal pup had taken up residence in a harbor in New Zealand. And I apologize to anyone from that region for the accent, but it cut to the local sheriff who just, and I won't actually do the accent, he just looks into the camera and goes, yeah, he's a little bit aggressive. And then it smash cuts to this 8 foot tall muscle worm, literally just going, and destroying the front end of a car.
Wasn't he like bouncing up and down on a car?
Yes. Yes.
Muscle worm! Oh my god.
I love stuff like that. Anyway, we have talked tremendously about some fantastic detail, like your amazing work. I'm curious about one thing.
Oh, I have something else I want to talk about too.
Who do you read? Who do you go to?
Right now?
Yeah. What are you into?
I read a lot of Kat Valente, Stephen Graham Jones. I have mentioned this in every single interview I've ever been on. I'll say it again. His book, Bomb Girls, is still, I think, a master class of writing. I think I reread that book once every 3 months or so, just trying to figure out how he does the prose, how he does the momentum of it, the horror and the humor at the same time. Mm. It's just perfect. Again, doing segues because I'm just nerding out about all my favorite people right now. There's a humanity to Stephen Graham Jones' books that I feel that a lot of horror writers shy away from. A lot of it feels like it should end terribly in a very nihilistic way, but there is always this note of extreme hope. It might be tarnished, it might be drenched in blood, but there is always hope and there is always a prayer for a better tomorrow in every one of his books. And it's amazing how he manages to do that without taking away the overwhelming like bleakness at the same time.
That's one of Alistair's favorite theories, though, isn't it?
That is the central, my central thesis at Pseudopod, that horror at its best is one of the most fundamentally hopeful genres.
Yes. I know a lot of people who prefer it deeply nihilistic, where it ends with your heart broken, but like, I don't know. In the heart of everything, there's always hope. It's just, are we willing to look for it?
Exactly.
Kat Valente has a recent book out, doesn't she? I'm trying to remember what her last one...
Comfort Me with Apple? Glass is Red?
I'm going to have to look it up.
Research.
Comfort Me with Apple.
Send me a couple of title recommendations, and then we'll put them in the stream show notes at the end of the stream for people who want to check them out later. Sound good?
Bomb Girls, Comfort Me with Apple... And now my brain is blanking. I really love Richard Cadry's Butcher Bird. It is very fundamental to a lot of my understanding of how writing could work and how genre can be messed around with. Butcher Bird, along with Planescape Torment, really shook up my understanding of literature and genre. Like, both of those properties basically looked at existing assumptions and went, nope, table flipped, kicked it over, and just stomped off to do their own thing.
Brilliant.
I can't look up things while the stream's going on because it'll get mad at me and it'll fall over. So I'll pick that up.
I do wonder sometimes whether that's one of the formative experiences that a lot of horror folks have in common, encountering those authors at a formative age, which just make you go, no, none of that. Sweep the table clear. This instead. I read Poppy Z. Bright when I was a heavily traumatized 19-year-old. Which is probably the best possible time to read Poppy Z. Bright. And that knocked me off the Arthur Mack and H.P. Lovecraft track.
And good! Glad to hear it!
Yeah, horror for me was that. It wasn't old dead white guys. Mm. And that changed my life. So I absolutely hear where you're coming from.
Of course, we haven't talked about your game writing, because we probably... can't, unfortunately. But one of my other favorite forms of your writing is you almost have the Platonic ideal of microfic down to a you have to follow Cassandra on Twitter, because every once in a while Cassandra will just decide, okay, give me a blah. And then they will do like 75 pieces of microfic about every type of blah that you name. And they're all just wonderful. I think actually the shorter the better with some of your work. Like, it exactly goes back to that whole filigree and Baroque thing. You put so much into one sentence that when you keep yourself to just one sentence, the best way to describe fan fiction is they are idea grenades, right? They blow up, they do what they're supposed to come for, they don't hang around. I need to come up with something better to describe microfiction, because it's like a teeny tiny intense grenade or something. Fictional canapes. Okay. You're very good. I'm very good at fictional canapes. Yeah. And you and I have talked about this before, about podcasting microfic or doing collections of microfic, because you're really good at them and I want them.
I'm going to write that of your microfic
down with this whole audio drama idea for next year. Microfic plus audio drama plus Cassandra Khaw equals something coming soon to a podcatcher near you, I'm sure. We'll come up with something.
I will be down with that.
With canapes!
With canapes. Canapes made to look like a bloody bits of things that they aren't actually.
Oh, God, this...
But also, like...
This marketing campaign is writing itself. I mean, geez.
You good?
You still there?
I was going to say that a lot of... Hello?
Yeah, you're good.
Go ahead.
Okay. A lot of my microfiction really is influenced by other, like, predecessors. I read a lot of Hoechlin stuff. Hoechlin is an amazing Twitter account. That feels like excerpts from documentaries and nature guides of a world that doesn't exist. Micro FFF as well does incredibly beautiful things. And I think Micro FFF was my first exposure to the idea of microfiction. And it's just this fascinating study, honestly, of how much you can pack into a small space. And I kind of iterated on that until I managed to come to my own microfiction, which in a weird way has always been like my writing warm-ups before I start any writing.
Yeah, I think I remember you saying that these were your warm-ups. And then, of course, you get 300 likes and you're like, well, that's my day. Oh, dear. You were crushed under your own success with those sorts of things. But...
Oh, God, I remember a few of those. I was like, I'm just going to do some, oh, God, I have 400 of these. What am I going to do with my life now?
Yeah. Exactly. But no, I would love the idea of you doing something more with that. I mean, I love Hoechlin. You're the same way with like Atlas Obscura. Those are a little more longer form, but the idea of having like just streams of standalone developed concepts.
Trevor Henderson stuff as well.
Little seeds, little grenades, little canapes are really, really fun.
Henderson's a really interesting example of that. He's an artist and uses common characters across his pieces, and is now very slowly folding fiction and mythos in under them. I would suggest people Google the word siren head, but it's late at night, and I'm guessing some of you would like to sleep.
Yeah, maybe
not. Siren head is very distressing.
Yes.
I remember that one. That's the one where you didn't sleep all that well then, isn't it?
And UFO abduction narratives. I'm a credulous boy.
Yes.
Yeah.
No, don't be doing that. Don't be doing that. Where's the kitty treats?
There's a kitty treat, but a kitty is kind of sitting on a chair staring at me. If no one minds me sneaking away for 2 seconds to go around, I can bring a kitty over.
I don't mind. If you'd like to. Kitty sounds good.
I shall bring a kitty over.
Kitty!
Incoming kitty.
Do you love a kitty? And then...
The kitten ran away.
Run away! Okay, no kitty for us, it seems like. Of course not. Oh, of course not. We want the cat now. We can't have the cat when we want the cat. What would that be?
They're always like that. If I'm not on camera, if there's no one asking for them, I have two giant cats just in my face like, hello, mother.
Of course. But now that you're like, hello, I wish to spotlight you, they're like... It's a little off-human. Yeah, not going to do it.
There's a book coming out towards the end of the year called Campaigns and Companions.
Oh, I'm so excited for that one.
The premise of which is, what if your pets played D&D and were kind of jerks about it? And the one that absolutely killed me was knock at the door. Orc opens it. Cat standing there. GM's like, what are you doing? Nothing. Orc looks at the cat for 10 minutes, closes the door, sits back down. There's a knock at the door, opens it. The cat's standing there. What are you doing? Nothing. Orc stares at it, sits back down. Knock at the door, opens it. The cat's sitting there. What are you doing? Still nothing.
Yes. Yes.
These are absolutely my cats. When I go to the shower and I pull the sliding door closed, the smaller one's constantly pawing me.
Oh, God.
Wow. And I open up, I'm like, did you want to get into the water? Did you want to see me? And she'll just come to the open door, just stare at me, just completely silent. I close it again. Wow. And I'm like, what?
You fool! That's water! What are you doing?
It'll kill you!
It's like trying to save you. Yo, you idiot! Get out of there! Run while you still can! Oh, God. Yes. Don't we love cats? Fantastic. All right, so what are the release dates? Because, you know, I've already read Nothing But Blackened Teeth, but I think everybody else has to wait till...
October?
October 19th, and The All-Consuming World is September 7th.
Fantastic. Who, remind us of the publishers again?
The publisher for The All-Consuming World is Erewhon Books. And Nothing But Blackened Teeth is part of the inaugural lineup for Nightfire.
Yes, right. So Nightfire is the Tor.com horror imprint. And this is their first wave.
The Tor horror imprint. There's just an imprint for Tor.com.
Yeah.
Because Tor and Tor.com, it's like different. Forbidden Planet.
Just say Tor.
Forbidden Planet. They're different companies.
Yes, but it's confusing. It's new. It's awesome. You're going to want it. I read it very, very intensely.
Yeah.
And got sunburned. And it was amazing. So you will enjoy that. We will put full contact details for Cassandra in the show notes. Any final thoughts? This is a chance now for the audience to come up with questions while we vamp for a minute, because I should have asked about questions before I asked you when the books came out. Well, that's going
on. I will ask Cassandra the question which all guests simultaneously dread and expect, which is, what are you working on at the moment?
Don't say everything. I know that's accurate, but don't say it.
I'm working on a world-building document for an indie game that I'm desperately excited about. I am working on some elements of the coolest dating game ever. I'm working on a haunted... Well, not a haunted house novella, but there is a woman literally haunted by her house.
Oh my God, I'm sold.
I've been to the Winchester Mintry House. Don't push those buttons.
And I've enjoyed writing it because there's a lot of like messing around with spatial details. She glances over and there's just different colored doors, things like that. So she is literally being haunted by a house if she stays somewhere for far too long. And
yes.
And I'm still finishing out a werewolf novella, which is kind of mostly set in the real world. Everything's largely the same, except for one interesting detail, which is the existence of lycanthropy. And lycanthropy is interesting in that it's so infectious, like all other interpretations of it, but it's kind of triggered by abuse. It is triggered by PTSD and stuff because I guess it's exploration of the variety of things, including how I deal with my own CPTSD and how much of it for a long time came out as aggression. Because if you've been heard enough questions to a quarter enough, you end up kind of feral from so much exposure to danger. And I'm kind of looking at the literalization of that. And about 600 other things I can't actually talk about because I am so deeply under NDA. Someone will scream at me the moment I take off my headphones if I even mention their existence.
So everything.
Yeah.
You're working on everything again.
this also speaks to, there was a quote in an interview you did with Locus, which really jumped out, which, much like your comment about hope at the heart of Stephen Graham Jones stuff earlier, I just looked at and went, there are many, many reasons Cass is one of my friends, and now there is one more. And it was that horror is an act of exorcism. And the idea that this is a genre more than any other that encourages you to pull the things which you don't want to pull out into the light, knowing and having to trust that the process of pulling them out will be awful, but putting them in the light will be awful for them. Mm-hmm. And I really respond to and respect the fact that you do that with your work, and that you do it with such remarkable honesty and compassion. It's one of the things
And courage, to be honest.
Jesus
you
Christ,
you are one
yes.
of the most fearless people we know.
You
I don't know if I'm fearless as opposed to too stupid to realize I'm in danger.
No,
you're fearless.
Because you're not too stupid to know that you have been in dangerous situations or put yourself in dangerous situations. You have that self-awareness. You didn't let it stop you. That's fearlessness.
You're kind of a badass, buddy.
Yeah, you're kind of nothing. Kind of totally a badass. We have a couple questions from the chat, if you're okay with it.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, so Ocean asks, as the local monster hugger, are the monsters in Food of the Gods huggable?
Some. Most would advise that you do not hug them, but I think most of them will tolerate a hug for at least a few minutes until they decide whether you're edible or not.
Hug with caution.
Yes.
Is how I'm going
hug
to
with caution.
Hug with caution. And then, what's your favorite comfort meal to cook for yourself right now?
Questions.
Yeah, not only what are you reading right now, but what are you cooking right now? Because we are in a fascinating era for home cooks, because we've all been in lockdown for going on 18 months. And so, I mean, for the love of God, I have a celebrity sourdough starter. That's how our home cooking went. And but we've been doing that for a year and a half now. So, you know, having gone through all of that, where are you now in your home cooking cycle? Are you in the, I'm going for my own Michelin star? Or are you in, fuck it, I'm just going to go back to eating ramen? Or, you know, where are you?
I'm cutting for my weightlifting stuff, so I've been leaning very healthy lately, and my favorite thing to do right now is this black bean and mushroom and wild rice burger with a single layer of like blue cheese placed on top of it with corn relish and brioche bread.
You had me at all of that, but strangely, the corn relish is what I really went, no, I need to eat this.
I make a really good grilled corn relish with radishes and cilantro. That's just
cilantro.
Like amazing on fish tacos. That's really good.
That's my comfort food right now.
That sounds amazing.
That sounds
really good. And the chat is just like, well, I need to eat this now. Immediately.
Exactly. Fantastic. Do you know about Chungus? Have we explained Chungus to you?
Chungus is our doubt? Yes.
Okay.
Good.
I've seen Chungus everywhere across Twitter, and I'm amazed at how famous Chungus is.
I have a Chungus keychain now, too.
What?
I know. Wendy made them for all of our Twitch mods, which is wonderful. And Chungus's wardrobe is starting to rival mine. It's just
he doesn't need a trailer
ridiculous
yet.
Like, he has his own like box, IKEA box of wardrobing. One of these days, I'm actually gonna set up. We bought a green screen, but we bought the big photo drop variety of it, not like the little pop up ones. And it has a white and black photo background. So one of these days, like, I need to set it up, and I'll test it by doing the, like, Chungus photo shoot. Because that's how lockdown is going for us right now. We're going to get to the point where we have a professional model of a sourdough starter.
You do know I'll do the Austin Powers thing, right? You know I'll do that. I'm not even cheating. There's no film in the camera.
But how am I going to record you doing that while taking the pictures of the sourdough? It's like very confusing. It's very Inception-y.
Rehearsals.
Oh my God.
Be fine.
It'll be fine.
Cassandra, this has been a delight.
Thank you so much for
joining
us.
Thank you so much for coming
really
on. This
nice
has been lovely.
Thank you so much for having
me. I'm sorry we couldn't get the kitty on camera.
We miss you too, buddy.
Oh, we will have to hang out when I come back to Europe permanently next year.
Nice.
Fantastic.
That sounds good. Alrighty.
And yes,
I think it's the first place I've announced it officially, but I'm going home to Europe by 2022.
God damn it. the god damn it is silent, I take it.
We'll have to do flesh and buns again. Yeah. That'll be
Thank
great.
You for having.
Yeah, fantastic. Okay, everybody, we are going to say goodbye to Cassandra real quick, and then we will be back with some shenanigans. So get up. We've been going for over an hour, so get up, get a stretch, get a drink of water. Please, in this heat, have a drink of water. Attend to medications or pets or any of that other good stuff. And we will be with you in a few minutes, she says, as she awkwardly changes the camera.
It's fine. It's fine. No one can see. It's really slick. It's very professional. No one's paying any attention.
Okay. We'll be right back.